Good morning everyone. Today we are starting the second module of fluid mechanics and hydraulics. This is the syllabus of the second module and it starts with buoyancy and flotation. So we'll be covering the first portion of the module 2 today. So I think we can directly move into the topic buoyancy and flotation. So if a body is placed over a liquid, it either floats or sinks. So it's a very clear thing that you are keeping something, some body on a liquid, whether it is water or some other liquid, it may either float on the surface of the liquid or it may sink. So when you keep a body like that, what are the forces that are acting on the body? The forces acting on the body are the weight of the body acting downwards and upward thrust of water on the body. So the body will be having a weight which is acting in the downward direction, and you all have felt when you try to insert or immerse something into a liquid, you will feel a upward thrust onto the body, that upward thrust acting on the body in the upward direction. The body floats if the upward thrust is more than the weight of the body. So we have mentioned about two forces, the weight of the body and the upward thrust. So if the upward thrust is more, then the body will float on the surface of the liquid, and the upward thrust exerted by the liquid on the body is called the buoyant force or buoyancy. So you might have heard or studied about in the lower classes. So when you immerse a body onto a liquid, the liquid exerts a force on the body, upward force on the body, and this upward force is known as buoyant force or buoyancy. Now, what is the magnitude of this buoyancy, or what is the value of this buoyancy? The magnitude of buoyancy is equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by the body. It is a very important point. The magnitude of the buoyancy is equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by the body. That is, when you keep a material or a body in a liquid, it removes some water, it displaces some water, and it occupies the position, isn't it? So that amount of fluid that is the, or the weight of the fluid that is displaced by the body gives you the magnitude of buoyancy. Clear? So buoyancy, as you know, is the upward thrust acting on the body when the body is immersed in a liquid. And when the body is immersed in a liquid, it removes or it displaces some amount of liquid and it occupies that space. So the weight of the liquid displaced will be equal to the buoyant force. The point of application of the buoyant force is called center of buoyancy. It's the point of application where this buoyant force acts. That point is called center of buoyancy. The center of buoyancy will be seen as center of gravity of the displaced fluid. So where does the center of buoyancy come? It comes at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. That is, when you immerse a body into a liquid, it displaces some amount of liquid, isn't it? So there is a region from where the liquid is displaced, and the center of buoyancy or the point where the buoyant force acts will be at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. Now coming to the principle of flotation, it is a very familiar thing to all of you. It is otherwise known as Archimedes principle. You might have heard the story of Archimedes, Eureka story of Archimedes. So that is Archimedes principle. It states that whenever a solid body is immersed wholly or partly in a liquid, it is lifted up by a force which is equal to the weight of the liquid displaced by the body. So that is exactly what we have explained in the previous slide. So principle of flotation or Archimedes principle states that whenever a solid body is immersed wholly or partly in a liquid, it is lifted up by a force which is equal to the weight of the liquid displaced by the body. The body loses as much of its weight as the weight of the liquid displaced by it. So when the body is immersed, as you know, when a body is immersed in liquid, it experiences a loss of weight, and the body loses its, the spelling is LOSES. Please make that correction. It is not LOO. It is LOSES. Okay. So the body loses as much of its weight as the weight of the liquid displaced by it. So what amount of liquid is displaced by the body? That amount of weight is lost for the body. So this is the figure that explains you the principle of flotation. So here three bodies are shown. First is body sinking, that is the body is coming to the bottom of the liquid. When does it happen? When the weight of the body is more than the buoyant force. W is the weight of the body and FB is the buoyant force. So when W is greater than FB, the body will sink. When W is equal to FB, what will happen? The body floats and touches the liquid surface. So the body will be like this when the weight of the body is equal to the buoyant force. Now what will happen when the weight of the body is less than the buoyant force? So here the buoyant force or the upward thrust is more, and with the upward thrust it pushes it up to this point and it will float on the surface of the liquid. So three cases are mentioned here. When the weight of the body is greater than the buoyant force, the body will sink. When the weight of the body is equal to the buoyant force, the body floats and touches the liquid surface like this. And when W, weight of the body, is less than the buoyant force, then the body will float like this. Any body existing in a liquid, the forces acting on the body are the weight of the body and the buoyant force. The body floats or sinks depending on the magnitude of W and FB. That is exactly what is explained with the figure. If FB is greater than W, the body will rise until its weight becomes equal to the buoyant force and the body floats in equilibrium. So when FB is more than W, here FB is more than W, what will happen? The body will rise until its weight becomes equal to the weight of the buoyant force. So the body will rise. It doesn't go to the bottom. It will rise and till what point it will rise? Until the weight becomes equal to the buoyant force and the body floats in equilibrium. Until the weight of the body becomes equal to the buoyant force, it will rise and the body will float in equilibrium. If FB is equal to W, the body floats touching its top surface to the free surface of the liquid. You have seen it in the figure. Then if FB is less than W, the body will sink to the bottom of the tank. Now the next topic is center of buoyancy. So here figure shows buoyancy of a fully submerged body and a partially submerged body in equilibrium. Let G be the center of gravity of the whole body and B be the center of buoyancy. See, this is a body which is sunk to the bottom of the liquid. Two points are there, center of gravity and center of buoyancy. So, center of gravity and center of buoyancy will be coinciding in the case of a body which is sinking or fully submerged body. See here, you can also see a partially submerged body, that is a portion of it is open to the atmosphere and a portion of it is submerged. So in such a case, G and B will not be coinciding. G will be at the same point as before, but B will be shifted. Where does B come? B will come at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. So this much is the displaced liquid and this is the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. So what happens here? In the first figure, how does the two points coincide? So, G is the center of gravity of the body and B is the center of buoyancy. Where does B come? B comes at the at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. So, here the displaced liquid is the circle itself, isn't it? This ball has displaced this much water or this much liquid and has occupied this position. So the center of gravity of the displaced liquid will be same as the gravity of the displaced liquid will be same as the center of gravity of the body itself. So the buoyant force the buoyant force will be acting at the center of gravity itself. For a fully submerged body, the volume of liquid displaced by the body is equal to the volume of the whole body itself. The center of buoyancy B coincides with the center of gravity of the body G. Now, coming to partially submerged body, the volume of liquid displaced by the body is equal to the volume of the portion of the body submerged in the liquid. So, whatever is the portion of the body that is submerged in liquid, that much liquid it has removed or displaced, and the center of buoyancy will be at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid alone. The center of buoyancy is the center of gravity of the displaced liquid by the immersed portion of the body. B is located below G, that is, center of buoyancy will be located below the center of gravity. Next topic is stability of floating and submerged bodies. So we are considering the stability of two types of bodies, floating bodies and submerged bodies. First, we will see the stability of a submerged body. The position of center of gravity and center of buoyancy in case of a completely submerged body are fixed. A body, when it is completely submerged in a liquid, the center of gravity will be at the point where it was initially, and center of buoyancy will also be fixed because it is completely submerged. There is no chance of displacement of the center of buoyancy. So it is fixed position. Now consider a balloon which is completely submerged in air. Air is also a fluid. The lower portion of the balloon contains a heavy material so that its center of gravity is lower than the center of buoyancy as shown in figure A. See the figure. So this is figure A. This is a balloon which is submerged in air. This lower portion of the balloon contains a heavy metal. So this center of gravity is located here and center of buoyancy at this portion. Okay. Now what is happening? It is given a small angular displacement like this. So this axis itself will turn to a particular angle. Now when it is given an angular displacement, this W and F will constitute a couple. It forms a couple, and this couple will be acting in the anti-clockwise direction, and it will bring the balloon back to its original position. That is what is called stable equilibrium. Okay, so I'll tell you again, this is the balloon which is having some heavy metal at the bottom, and because of the heavy metal, the center of gravity is acting here and center of buoyancy is acting here. And here we are giving a, here there is no couple acting because these two are acting along the same line. So here, when we are giving the balloon an angular displacement, what happens? The axis turns like this. So when the axis is turned like that, then this W and FB will constitute a couple. It forms a couple, and that couple will be acting in the anti-clockwise direction, and that will bring the balloon back to its original position, and that is known as stable equilibrium. So when does stable equilibrium acts? When W is equal to FB and G, or center of gravity, is below the center of buoyancy, that is considered as stable equilibrium. Now coming to unstable equilibrium, see the position of the balloon. The heavy metal is here. So because of that, the center of gravity is above the center of buoyancy. So this is the original position of the balloon, and here also, like in the first case, we are giving an angular displacement. So the axis turns like this, and now what happens here is, here also W and FB constitute a couple, but that couple is also acting in the clockwise direction. So the moment is in the clockwise direction, and the formed couple is also in the clockwise direction. So it will not bring the balloon back to its original position, and this equilibrium is called unstable equilibrium. So here it is stable because the balloon is brought back to the original position by the formation of the couple. But here the movement is in the clockwise direction and the couple is also moving, acting in the clockwise direction, and it will not help in bringing the balloon back to its original position, and it is known as unstable equilibrium. So unstable equilibrium happens when W is equal to FB and G is above B. Center of gravity is above the center of buoyancy. And the third one is neutral equilibrium. That happens when B and G coincides, that is center of gravity and center of buoyancy are acting at the same point. That state is called neutral equilibrium. So this is what is explained here. The weight W is acting through G vertically in the downward direction, while the buoyant force FB is acting vertically up through the point B. For equilibrium of the balloon, W, weight of the body, should be equal to the buoyant force. If the balloon is given an angular displacement in the clockwise direction, as shown in the figure, then W and FB constitute a couple acting in the anti-clockwise direction and brings the balloon back to its original position. The balloon in position shown by figure A is said to be in stable equilibrium. So the condition for stable equilibrium is when W is equal to FB and point B is above G. Now coming to unstable equilibrium, the condition is if W is equal to FB and B is below G, the body is said to be in unstable equilibrium as shown in figure B. A slight displacement of the body in the clockwise direction forms a couple due to W and FB, and this couple is also acting in the clockwise direction. Thus, the body does not return to its original position. Now, the last equilibrium, neutral equilibrium. If FB is equal to W and B and G are at the same point as shown in figure C, the body is said to be in neutral equilibrium. Now coming to the stability. Next topic is stability of floating bodies. So before going to the stability of the floating bodies, we need to know a term, metacenter. It is defined as the point at which a body starts oscillating when the body is tilted by a small angle. So you have a floating body. If you are tilting the floating body by a small angle, it will oscillate for some time, and the point about which the body oscillates is called the metacenter. It is also defined as the point at which the line of action of the force of buoyancy will meet the normal axis of the body when the body is given a small angular displacement. I'll explain this statement with a figure. Consider a floating body in liquid as shown in figure A. Let the body is in equilibrium and G is the center of gravity and B is the center of buoyancy. For equilibrium, both the points lie on the normal axis, which is vertical. So this is the figure. This is the initial position. The body is floating and here comes the normal axis, and B and G both are lying on the normal axis. Now what happens? We are giving a small angular displacement to the floating body. So here the center of buoyancy will be shifted to new position, say B1. Why the center of buoyancy becomes shifted? Where does the center of buoyancy come? Center of buoyancy comes at the center of the displaced liquid. So here when the body is immersed onto the liquid, this much portion of the liquid is displaced, isn't it? So the center of buoyancy is acting exactly at the center of gravity of the displaced portion of the liquid. So that is why the body point B comes here. Now the body is given a displacement here. Here the displaced liquid, the shape of the displaced liquid changes. Here it was rectangular, but here it is in some other shape. So the center of buoyancy will be coming at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. So the center of buoyancy gets shifted to the point B1. Center of gravity will be acting at the same point itself. Okay, so in the new position, this is the point where the buoyant force acts. Okay, now what is metacenter? When this buoyant force is extended to in the vertical direction, that line of action will meet the normal axis at one point, point M, and that point is called the metacenter. I'll explain once again. This is the normal axis. B and G are lying in the normal axis like this. Now, when the object or the body is given an angular displacement, the center of buoyancy shifts to the new location B1. So the buoyant force is acting through the center of buoyancy. Now, if we are extending the line of action of the buoyant force, that extended line will meet the normal axis at one point. And this point is called the metacenter. And when the body is tilted, the body will oscillate for some time, and that oscillation takes place about the metacenter. This is the explanation given here. Let the body is given a small angular displacement in the clockwise direction as shown in figure B. The center of buoyancy, which is the center of gravity of the displaced liquid or center of gravity of the portion of the body submerged in the liquid, will now be shifted towards the right from the normal axis. That is, B1 is the new center of buoyancy. The line of action of the force of buoyancy in the new position will intersect the normal axis of the body at some point, say M. And this point M is known as the metacenter. The distance MG, that is the distance between the metacenter of the floating body and the center of gravity of the body, is called metacentric height. So the distance from M to G. What is M? M is the metacenter and G is the center of gravity of the body. This distance is called metacentric height. So now we will learn the stability of a floating body. It is determined from the position of the metacenter M. In case of floating body, the weight of the body is equal to the weight of the liquid displaced. So here also, like in the submerged body, you have three conditions: stable equilibrium, unstable equilibrium, and neutral equilibrium. So we will see one by one and we'll learn it with the help of this figure. This is the floating body. This B is the center of buoyancy and G is the center of gravity. Both are acting in the normal axis like this. Now, we are giving a disturbing couple or an angular displacement to this floating body. So what happens when an angular displacement is given? When an angular displacement is here, the point B gets shifted, center of buoyancy gets shifted to a new location. So earlier when we studied the stability of the submerged body, when the body shifts, the center of gravity and center of buoyancy are in fixed position. Why? Because center of buoyancy is at the center of gravity of the displaced liquid. Since the body is fully submerged, the position of the center of buoyancy will not change even if it is tilted. But here, when the body is tilted, the center of gravity of the displaced liquid shift, and because of that reason, the center of buoyancy gets shifted to the new location B1. Now, in the new position, here is the center of buoyancy, and FB, or the center of the buoyant force, is acting through B1. Now, if you extend the line of action of the center of line of action of the buoyant force, that extended line will meet the normal axis at a point, and this point is called the metacenter. Okay, that we have already learned. So here M is the metacenter. Now what is the effect of this? So B has been shifted to B1. Now W and FB will constitute a couple, and that couple will be acting in the anti-clockwise direction, and that couple helps to bring the body back to its original position, and this condition is known as stable equilibrium. So when does stable equilibrium occur? Stable equilibrium occur when the metacenter comes above the center of gravity. So only then the constituted couple will be acting in the anti-clockwise direction, and that will help to bring the body back to its original position. So this is called stable equilibrium when M is above G. Now we will see what unstable equilibrium is. So this is the initial position. G is acting here, B is here. Now we are giving an angular displacement to the body. So when an angular displacement is given, the center of buoyancy gets shifted to the new position B1, like in the previous case itself. Now the center of buoyancy is at B1 and the buoyant force is acting through B1. Now when we extend the line of action of the buoyant force, that will cut the normal axis at the point called M, which is the metacenter. Now observe the position of the metacenter here. Here the metacenter is below the center of gravity. Here the metacenter was above the center of gravity. Now what is the effect here? Now the weight of the body and the buoyant force will constitute a couple which is also acting in the clockwise direction. So that will not help the body to return back to its original position, or in turn that will only make the body overturn, and this is called unstable equilibrium. So unstable equilibrium occurs when M comes below G. So this is what is written here. First is stable equilibrium. If the point M is above G and the floating body will be in stable equilibrium as shown in figure, if a slight angular displacement is given to the floating body in the clockwise direction, the center of buoyancy shift from B to B1 such that the vertical line through B1 cuts at M, which is the metacenter. Then the buoyant force FB through B1 and the weight W, these are the two forces acting there. Weight W through G constitute a couple acting in the anti-clockwise direction, thus bringing the floating body in the original position. Now the second case, unstable equilibrium. If the point M is below G, the floating body will be in unstable equilibrium as shown in figure B. The disturbing couple is acting in the clockwise direction, and the couple due to buoyant force and W is also acting in the clockwise direction, thus overturning the body. So the couple formed will not help the body to come back to its original position, or otherwise it will only cause the overturning of the floating body, and this equilibrium is called unstable equilibrium. Now neutral equilibrium. If the point M is at the center of gravity of the body, that condition is called neutral equilibrium. That is when the metacenter and the center of gravity coincides, that state is called neutral equilibrium. Next topic is experimental determination of metacentric height. So how can you find out the metacentric height experimentally? As we know, the metacentric height is the distance between the metacenter and the center of gravity. So for that, we can consider a floating body like this. This is a floating body and a weight W1 is placed over the floating body. So the total weight now is capital W, that is the weight of the floating body along with the weight W1 is capital W. So this is the initial position. Now in the second figure, the weight W1 has moved by a distance. Initially it was placed here. Now W1 has moved by a distance x. Okay. So since it is moved, the body will tilt. So this is the new position. Here the center of buoyancy has shifted to new position B1 and the center of gravity has shifted to the new position G1. Why the center of gravity has shifted? Because the weight W1 has moved to a new position. So the center of gravity has also shifted to the position G1. So here theta is the angle of tilt. that is the tilt has happened by an angle theta. This theta can be measured using the attachments given to the object, like a protractor and a plumb line is attached along with the experimental setup, and theta can be measured. Now coming to the theory, the metacentric height of a floating body can be determined if the center of buoyancy of the floating body is known. Let W1 is the known weight placed over the center of body and the body is floating. Let the capital W be the weight of the body including W1. Let G be the center of gravity of the body and B be the center of buoyancy. Now in the second figure, the weight W1 has moved across the body towards the right through a distance x as shown in figure 2. Now the body will be tilted. The angle of heel theta is measured by means of a plumb line and a protractor attached to the body. So this is an experimental setup. So we have a attachment for measuring the angle of tilt, and the angle theta can be measured. The center of gravity of the body will be shifted as the weight W1 has moved to the right. So from the initial position, there is a change in the position of W1. Since W1 has moved, the center of gravity has also been shifted. Let the new center of gravity be G1, and also the center of buoyancy will change to B1. As the body has tilted under equilibrium, the moment caused by the movement of the load W1 through a distance x must be equal to the moment caused by the shift of the center of gravity from G1. So this is the principle used here to find out the metacentric height. Since the body has tilted in equilibrium, the moment caused by the movement of the W1 through x, that moment must be equal to the moment caused by the shift of the center of gravity from G to G1. So these two moments can be equated, and from that the metacentric height can be found out. Okay, I'll explain here what are the two moments that are equated. The moment caused due to the movement of W1 through a distance x, and the moment caused by the shift of the center of gravity from G to G1. That is, the weight of the body has shifted from G to G1. By equating these two moments, we can find out the metacentric height. First, we will write the first moment, the moment due to the change of G from G to G1. The moment due to the change of G or center of gravity is GG1 into W. See the figure. So GG1 is the perpendicular height from here. So GG1 into W is the moment caused by the shift of the center of gravity from G to G1. So the moment due to the change of the center of gravity is GG1 into W. Now from the figure, write what tan theta is. So this is a right angle triangle, and from this tan theta will be equal to GG1 by GM, isn't it? Opposite by adjacent. So GG1 by GM. So tan theta is GG1 by GM. From this, here there is a small mistake. So write from this equation, write what is GG1. GG1 is GM into tan theta, isn't it? Now substitute that GG1 here. You will get the moment due to the change of G as GM tan theta into W, because GG1 is GM tan theta. So the moment due to the change of G is GM tan theta into W. Please make that correction in your notebook. Now we'll write the other moment, moment due to the movement of W1. W1 is the small weight which is placed over the floating body, and it has moved by a distance x. Now the moment produced is W1 into x. Now we can equate these two moments. W1 into x is equal to W into GM into tan theta, this moment. So W1 into x is equal to W into GM tan theta. Therefore GM from this equation is W1 into x by W tan theta. So using this equation, we can find out the metacentric height experimentally. Now coming to the analytical determination of metacentric height, that is, How can we find out the metacentric height using an equation? So this is the equation available for finding out the metacentric height. Gm is equal to I by V bar minus Bg. Now what are these terms? I is the moment of inertia of the plan of the body, not the point. Where I is the moment of inertia of the plan of the body. That is, when you look from the top, what is the shape that you see? You have to take the moment of inertia of that shape. I is the moment of inertia of the plan of the body about the yy axis. That is what is given here in the numerator. V bar is the volume of the body submerged in water. It is not the total volume of the body. It is the volume of the submerged portion of the body. So V bar is the volume of the body submerged in water, and Bg is the distance between the center of gravity and the center of buoyancy. That is aware. B is the center of buoyancy and G is the center of gravity, and Bg is the distance between the two. So using this relation, we can find out the metacentric height analytically. Gm is equal to I by V bar minus Bg.